Welcome to the Solar Energy Channel, where you'll get an honest inside look at all things solar. Today, I have with me our president and CEO, Dale Good, and we're going to talk about the domestic content adder that the guidance was released earlier this week on Monday, May 15th, right around 9 o'clock or so in the morning. The IRS put out their guide, the initial guidance for this, and I don't know if it's exciting or nerve-wracking, but we're going to talk about what we know and what we understand about it after reading it two or three times. So welcome, Dale.
Good to be here, Warren.
Thank you. So Dale, why don't we start off and just give, first of all, if you haven't already watched, we've put out a video on the low income adder as well as the energy community adders. So if you take a look at that, if you haven't already, and this is the third adder that we're going to be discussing for the domestic content. We don't have any guidance yet with regards to the direct pay, but as soon as we do, we'll put that out as well. So, Dale, with regard to the domestic content adder here, why don't we start off and talk about some of the more simple things in the guidance here? Maybe the percentage the percentage for different for steel versus manufactured products and the years that those will increase.
Yeah, so there's basically two categories, Warren. There's the category for what they call steel and iron.
Yep.
And that's a pretty simple one. It's either made in the U.S. or it's not. So, you know, that's the easy one. The manufactured product is the second category. And if a manufactured product, it's interesting, even in reading the notice, it was a little bit confusing. They use some of the same words, like components, like they have project components and they had manufactured product components. Well, those are different components, what they're talking about. So it was a little confusing. But if a manufactured product is made entirely in the U.S. and all of the components of that manufactured product are all made in the U.S., it's pretty simple. But if not, it starts to get confusing. So around the manufactured products, with the cast iron and the steel, it's 100% in the U.S. That includes rebar in the foundation, everything that's foundational, that's structural, the structure you're building. For the manufactured products, there is a step up that's going to occur, and it starts at 40%. So basically, if you look at the cost of manufactured products on a project, if 40% of that is U.S. made, then it would qualify for this 10% adder. Now, there's a couple other caveats around that, like the size of the project. If it's over a megawatt, they have to meet, you know, they have to meet the prevailing wage and the apprenticeship program requirements and that kind of thing. If they don't meet those, it's only 2%. But assuming you meet all the other requirements, there's a 10% adder that's there. But it starts at 40% and it steps up eventually to 55% in the year starting in 2027. So that's going to be a challenge. And on top of that, it's the percentage that's required is determined by when you turn the system on, not when you start building it.
That could
be challenging.
Very challenging. So just to recap what you just said, any steel or iron or rebar or anything like that needs to be 100% U.S. made. If it's 90%, the entire project doesn't qualify.
That's all correct. Steel, I mean, if you miss iron, that one, you're done.
You're done. 100% of the iron and steel has to be manufactured and procured here in the United States.
Right.
When it comes to the manufactured components, right now, 40%, but that's going to step up in the coming years. 40% of the cost of the manufactured components need to be met in order for it to qualify.
Right.
And then within that, let's get to the more complicated parts, the components within the manufactured products and how that's going to be calculated. If some of the components in an inverter are made in the U.S. and some of them are not, how is that all going to play out?
I don't know, but I'm glad I'm not a manufacturer. So they've got a rule built in here, Warren. It's called the adjusted percentage rule. And what they're going to look at is where the components inside the product come from. So, and they'll use a cost basis. Now, this is where it gets interesting to me, because you've got the taxpayer's going to have to file this, we as an installer are going to have to provide information to them, but we don't know the cost basis for the components that we're putting into a project. We're going to have to rely on our suppliers, manufacturers, or distributors to pass that information to us. And they're going to have to do those calculations to say 40% of my manufacturer, you know, my inverter, 40% of my inverter is US made, or 20%. I mean, it gets really interesting, because the way the 40% is calculated is you take the total cost for the project of manufactured items. So even if you don't have 20%, the way I understand it, even if you don't have 20% US made components in a product, and that product's part of your project, that would still calculate into the total, which could hurt you or could help you. It gets pretty complex.
That is. And so really, the responsibility obviously is on the taxpayer for maintaining accurate records when they file their taxes.
Right.
But they're going to need all of this documentation from us, and we need to get it from our suppliers and distributors, who get it from the manufacturers themselves, in order to do that.
Yeah, that's correct. And the it appears to me that the focus for the manufactured products is going to be on the inverters and modules.
Yeah.
Because what we call balance of system in solar world, which is the wiring, the nuts, the bolts, the, you know, the clamps, that stuff is kind of like outside the whole realm of this discussion. They just consider that like ancillary product. It's not steel and iron, because it's not considered structural. It's just the component. So I think the focus will be on inverters and modules, optimizers, the things that are actually part of the solar system that are not racking.
Now, Dale, when it comes to certifying, or that these components, or that these products have X amount of U.S. manufactured, that is completely up to the manufacturers and the distributors. The buyer of the system doesn't need to do any type of certification. Is that correct?
No, he doesn't need, he really couldn't, Warren, because he wouldn't, unless he's going to manufacture something that's part of a system, he has no hand in that. But the reality is, the taxpayer, from based on the notice that I've read, the taxpayer is responsible. So the taxpayer is going to have to provide that certification as part of his tax filing at year end. It has to get attached to the schedule, whichever one he's using. I think for the ITC, it's 3468. So he would have to attach it to the back of that to submit his tax return. There's also a really confusing statement about successive years, that you have to file it for the first year. But then it says that you have to file it also for successive years. It doesn't say when it stops. I'm guessing that means successive years if you're going to continue to take parts of the tax credit in future years. But it doesn't say that. So that's an assumption that I'm making. I don't know exactly when that stops, as far as being having the required certification attached to your tax forms, but it will be required of the taxpayer.
So when do you think, Dale, if somebody is interested in buying solar now, when do you think these manufacturers are going to have these certifications available for us?
Wow. I wish I knew.
Okay.
I think the immediate answer, Warren, is that there's very few modules that are going to meet the 100% rule.
Yeah.
Very few. There's some thin film, First Solar, probably one of them. But I think most of the modules that most of the installers are using in the US are not going to meet the 100% rule. And that's where this gets messy, because now you break it down into, well, is the aluminum frame made in the US? Is the glass on the module made in the US? Is the back sheet made in the US? Which parts are made in the US? What cost percentage is that of the entire project? And how does this all roll up? So I think 2023, there's going to be very little hardware that qualifies, very few systems that qualify.
Yeah, and the same is probably true for inverters, that there's very few manufacturers that are using U.S.-made components within those inverters. And so it seems to me that there's going to be a ramp-up time for the manufacturers to procure a source and build their products here with U.S.-made components to meet these certifications. And that's not going to happen in the coming months, as far as I can tell.
No, and for the manufacturer, there's even U.S. Manufacturers, Warren, that are basically relabeling hardware that's being made in other countries. That's not going to qualify. I mean, that doesn't matter where the company's headquarters are. So I think there's going to be very little hardware. The other interesting piece to me is that the cost basis has to include only basically raw direct costs, raw materials and direct labor. So I'm not sure how the manufacturers are going to show us that, because what we're paying them is not the cost basis, because we're paying them markup and overhead and other costs.
Sure.
So I see a tremendous burden on the manufacturers here.
Yeah, that's going to make it even more challenging to get to that 40% threshold.
Yes, but I think the 40% threshold will work off of that cost basis, not off the cost of the system.
Sure, sure.
But very challenging.
Absolutely. So I think to sum it up, Dale, if I'm correct with this entire domestic content, is that what we know now is that 100% of steel and iron needs to come from the United States. 40% of the total manufactured cost of any other manufactured components needs to come from the United States.
Right.
Most of the suppliers and manufacturers are responsible for certifying that they meet those requirements, and how much of those what percentage they meet. And that there's very little or few manufacturers in the United States, both on the inverter and the panel side, that will currently be able to certify them, other than maybe one or two thin film solar manufacturers here in the United States. And that it's going to be a real challenge meeting this requirement probably in the next 12 to 18 months until manufacturing picks up here in the United States.
I think absolutely it'll be a challenge. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good summary.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Dale. We appreciate you bringing us up to speed on this. And as I mentioned earlier, when we get more guidance on the direct pay, we'll release that as well. So thanks for watching. We hope you found this valuable.